All right, back in the action once again. Is it that time of day again? That time just flies right by when you're having fun. Hope you had a fantastic day, but it's time to get back to work though. We got to get ready for a big day coming to finish up the week tomorrow. It is, of course, that time of day again, Thursday afternoon, February 6, 2020. My name is Joseph, and as always, welcome back to your nightly newsletter. Now, if you're here for the first time, it's great to have you with me. I help traders find the best of the best entry setups using a very simple three-step strategy that we teach and trade together every morning at the opening bell. But don't forget, my job is a little bit different tonight. Tonight, my job is to help you guys find the best levels of support and resistance, the best entry setups and exit targets. And most importantly, my job tonight is very important to help keep us out of trouble by avoiding all the common traps waiting for tomorrow. That's non-farm Friday's trading session. And we have a jam-packed video for you guys and gals here tonight on the newsletter. As you can see in the background, all the charts are all prepped up. We get some oil, some S&P, some NASDAQ, and some gold. We'll prep all the charts up, make sure you know the best levels, the best setups for tomorrow's trading session. And of course, we'll grab the calendar. It's the end of the week. We got some big news tomorrow. We'll talk about the best times to be trading, when to sit on hands, and we'll cover it all in tonight's video. Before we jump in though, as always, I want to remind you, if you're here for the first time right now, make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel. I don't want you to miss every newsletter we publish every evening, so you're always ready for the next great trade setup. And don't forget, if you have any questions, drop those questions in the comments section below. I'll be hanging out after we publish the video tonight, making sure all the questions get answered. And as always, if you tune in every evening, if you watch this nightly newsletter every evening with me, hit that thumbs up button for me. If you're part of the newsletter group here at School of Trade and you tune in every evening, if you rely on this video newsletter to help you out in your trading, hit that thumbs up button for me. Always appreciate you guys tuning in and supporting this channel. So make sure you subscribe, type those questions down in the comments section below, hit that thumbs up button here before we get started. Speaking of which, let's get this party rolling here. We got time is ticking right now. Let's kick off tonight's video by checking the calendar for tomorrow, because again, it's non-farm Friday. Let's grab the economic news calendar first as we go into this Thursday evening. And of course, really there's one thing going on tomorrow. Well, maybe two things tomorrow, right? The first thing is, it is, of course, a Friday. And what does a Friday always tell me? Fridays always tell me the meat and potatoes, the best setups on Fridays are usually going to be between 8 o'clock and about 10:30 a.m. Eastern time. Now, you might push that back to 10:45, right? But you really got to have a good reason to be trading on a Friday morning after 11 o'clock, right? Professional traders know this. The later we get in the day on a Friday, the markets take bigger risks, we get less liquidity, the big fish leave the markets on Friday afternoon, and of course, the little fish get chopped up by all the sharks that come in on Friday afternoon. So the most important thing for a Friday, you know, and this is kind of no matter what Friday we have, it's early in, early out. Early in, early out. Get to those trades early. And again, 10:15, 10:30, 10:45, we'll be keeping our eyes on the price action tomorrow, kind of our proverbial finger on the pulse of this market. Once we start seeing things get loose, right, once we start seeing the moving average not holding, once we start seeing levels of support and resistance, right, not exactly holding as well, right, we'll know it's time to cut things off. Don't forget, tomorrow morning we'll be in our trade room as well at 8 o'clock Eastern time. That way we can trade this strategy together. Now, speaking of strategy for tomorrow, everybody has one thing on their mind tomorrow, and that is the employment number. Now remember, very, very important thing to keep in mind for tomorrow. We heard from the ADP employment report at 8:15 on Wednesday. Now why is that important? Well, the number on Wednesday morning was a pretty positive number, and that is important for us because as of Wednesday at 8:15 Eastern time, all the investment banks, all the prop firms, all the individual traders, everyone in the market now knows what is likely coming tomorrow morning at 8:30. Now, why is that important to me as a trader? Because you probably have heard this term before. The market is already priced in this news. The news is already baked into, as they say. What happens is when the news comes out on Wednesday, the markets, whether intentional or not, they tend to gravitate towards as if the news had already come out. Now, the reason why this is really important is because tomorrow morning, when that number comes out at 8:30 Eastern time, remember, it's the only news of the session. It's the only news that matters tomorrow. Everything else is swept under the rug. Everyone's watching the employment number at 8:30. But you've got to remember, right? These markets, again, whether intentional or not, have likely already priced in or baked in the news we saw on Wednesday, which was a pretty good number on Wednesday morning. What happens is, if the number comes out tomorrow at 8:30 within expectations, then oftentimes the market goes sideways and sticks inside of a range, because after all, if the news comes out as they were all anticipating, what is there left to do? They've already placed their bets. It's already priced in that news. But the fun part happens when the news comes out either higher or lower. If we exceed, right, or you know, underneath or above that kind of expectations band, right? They give you kind of a range of expectations. And I'm not going to go into too much detail on the specific expectations for tomorrow. But if we see a big number, bigger than expected, if we see a small number, smaller than expected, outside of your range of expectations, now what happens is, remember, the market's already priced in that news, and now traders have to respond. Remember, most traders going into Friday, if they already have a position on, they've got a plan B and a plan C. If we get above expectations, below expectations, if it comes out right on the number, they're already in the market. This is important for you tomorrow because, one, if the news comes out as expected, the market will typically sit, and it'll be very not disappointing, but you'll notice it'll be very slow and sluggish, and you got to give it 10 minutes or so to kind of get its act together, right? Because everyone's going to be sitting there waiting on something, and it won't happen if the number comes out as expected, right? The other side of that pendulum swing is the number comes out outside of expectations, higher or lower. Now traders have to react, and that's where the volatility comes in. Now, when that volatility comes in, it's oftentimes very violent between 8:30, 8:45, right? So give it 10, 15 minutes to let the dust settle, and then we'll find our new trends, update our charts, and of course, right, we'll formulate a new strategy after that fact comes out. So, moral of the story tomorrow, right? The most important thing is be careful around this news. If that number comes out right on expectations, it'll probably be sloppy, right? Sideways and quiet. Don't force it, right? Stay patient. But on the other side of the coin, if it comes out higher or lower, you now know it's going to be violent, most likely a very violent response to it, and you've got to let the dust settle because it'll be a very difficult market, right, to be trading. So that's the most important thing about tomorrow morning. We're going to get in our trade room tomorrow morning like we always do, 8 o'clock Eastern time. We'll update the charts. We'll wait for that news to come out, and we'll see how the market responds. We really can't make any assumptions based on the number. We have to wait and see how the market responds. That's the key topic for tomorrow. And again, get to them early tomorrow, right? 10:30, 10:45, you really got to be careful. It's a very small window of opportunity tomorrow, right? And we're going to make it count tomorrow in our trade room. If you're not with me tomorrow in the trade room, if you're in Asia, if you're in London, if you're trading before this news comes out, be careful. Markets like gold and currencies are usually very grindy and very inconsistent, almost lifeless, leading into these news numbers. A big number tomorrow at 8:30 Eastern time. So if you're trading in London, if things aren't moving, don't force it. You know they're waiting on that news number tomorrow. Now, I will be honest, we usually don't see a lot of good setups in the overnight because everyone's waiting for that big number tomorrow. But the last couple months, right, we've seen a lot of really great movement on markets like gold as traders start, you know, basically positioning themselves ahead of that news coming out tomorrow. So I don't want to say don't trade overnight, but keep your eyes open. Be aware of the reality. If the market's barely moving, you know what they're waiting for, and I wouldn't force it, right? I wouldn't force it. The big money is sitting on the sidelines until the number comes out. If it's moving overnight, then trade it. But be aware, if it's not the time to be forcing it, and we know what they're waiting on. Again, as always, tomorrow, make sure you join me 8 o'clock Eastern time, and we'll do it all together. If not, if you're not with me, be careful tomorrow before the news comes out. Please don't gamble on the response. Wait for the response, then trade the response to that news. Now we know the schedule for tomorrow. Early in, early out. Careful, careful, careful. And again, if you're on gold, right? Gold is one of those markets that tends to be really choppy around these big news events. So please be careful. And as always, you know where to find me tomorrow at 8 o'clock Eastern time. Now we know the schedule for tomorrow, right? Or the lack of schedule, I guess it would be, right? Not a lot to worry about except for that number at 8:30. Let's grab some charts here right now. Let's see if we can make some sense out of these. Now, I'm going to do my best tonight to put the strategy together, but you got to be aware, right? When that news number comes out tomorrow, this thing could get blown out. All these levels could get blown apart tomorrow if we do see a very big response to it. So I'm going to do my best tonight, right? We'll get it all prepped up. We'll update it as we see. It's the best I can do ahead of these major, major news events such as the non-farm payroll Friday. So let's jump right in. We got some oil, some S&P, some NASDAQ, and some gold. Let's jump out here with the black gold, the Texas tea, the crude oil futures. So what do we know about oil right now? The black gold, the Texas tea. Well, we know the bears have control, right? We know there is an overall bearish bias to it. In fact, if you were to look left, right, look left, you can see the market is very much overall a bear market. What does a bear market tell us? A bear market tells us we want to sell at levels of resistance, right? What else do we see here right now? We could definitely see there's a trading range. And that trading range is a really important clue because a trading range tells me I can use the size of that range as support, I can use that size of that range as resistance. And what do we do with the range bound market? We buy low, we sell high, and we avoid the middle. So we know we have a bear market that says I want to be a seller, I want to sell at resistance. And we also know there's a trading range on here, and the range gives us a great area of resistance overhead for us to be focused on that area, right, to be a seller. Now, what else do we know here right now? We're looking for more levels of resistance. Anytime I have a trading range environment, I always like to draw those trend lines up overhead, trend lines down underneath. And I want, of course, buy low, sell high, right? Buy low off the low, sell high up above that high. So we've got a pretty good understanding of what's going on. We know we're bearish. We know we're range bound. We've got some levels we're watching overhead. We got some levels we're watching here underneath. Pretty straightforward here on the crude. But there's one thing that really stands out to me, and you'll notice I kind of highlighted that right here with these question marks. Now, when we talk about trading ranges, ranges like to rotate back and forth. So once I have a range, we go from the low to the high to the low to high to low to high to low. We call that range rotation. Well, if I have a situation where the market goes up and then comes back down, and we don't, right, and we don't get that full rotation, right, what happens is it becomes more bullish. So when I look at this chart right now, I can see my range right here. I can see how the market punches it, right, pokes its head through the range, and usually the amount of the move above that range will come right back down and hit it on the opposite side. Look what happened. They didn't get those that follow through for the sellers. I would have expected those bears to get that trap off the high, the run back down, and buyers trying to buy it off that low. The bears did not get that rotation. And because of that, that really makes me think these buyers have something up their sleeve here in the next couple hours. I could easily see them trying to make a run for a retest of that high. That's the only real concern I see right now for being a seller. So I know I want to be a bear. I want to sell up overhead. What are the types of entry patterns we can use to be a seller on this market right now, right? Again, I'm already concerned. I'm a bit concerned here right now that we've got that lack of follow through, right? The amount of the move up, we didn't get any extension back on the other side. And that's a really bullish clue. It really is. So how do I sell it knowing that I've got those, that little voice in my head saying, yeah, we're not exactly as bearish as you might think. Bottom line is, I've got my level of resistance overhead, I've got my areas overhead, I've marked up this pendulum swing, right, as a level of resistance. I really like this area up overhead. But just like we talked about on gold last night, if the market keeps running higher here right now, is that gonna feel very bearish? It's probably not. It's probably going to feel pretty bullish, isn't it? We already saw evidence that the bulls are a lot stronger than we might have first assumed they are. And so now if I can get that move up into that range, I would typically look for just a straight buyer failure into a seller pullback combination going back into that range, right? We talk about that pattern a lot on this newsletter, right? So, you know, typically I would look for a move up. I'd look for those buyers to buy the pullback off the EMA, and I would sell right into those stop losses. Now, I want to do something similar to that, but now what I want to do is I want to get up into my battle zone, up into my sell zone, but now I want to respect that momentum. Well, again, it's not what did happen, it's what didn't happen right down here. I want to respect that bullish tone to it. Let those buyers try once, let them try twice, and then sell it back down again. Does that make sense? Right? So we know we're bearish. The buyers haven't taken it yet, but we're starting to see some clues, right? If you know how a range should react, if we poke our heads above, we should poke our heads below. The lack of that poke, right? The lack of that poke, pardon the term, right, is a big clue now. These buyers may be a lot stronger, right, than I think they are. So now we know kind of the pattern I'm looking for to sell off this high. As we go up, I'm now going to look to short it, but I'm going to wait for the one, the two for the buyers, right, and then go from there. It'll look a lot like this one back here, right, where they make a run up, right, the buyers try once, buyers try twice, and they collapse back down. Think about that pattern over here now, right? Up, again, momentum will look pretty strong there. One, two, and then sell it back down from there. Now, how else could I sell this market? Another way I could sell it would be if we make a nice run going lower and we keep going. Remember, what does a range tell me to do? Ranges tell me to buy low and sell high, right? Buy low, sell high. So if we go lower here, I wanna be a buyer down here. I don't wanna be a seller. So if I wanna be a seller, I can sell high, right off that high, but I've got to wait for a breakout of this trading range. And this is where things are going to get a little bit dicey here, because you got that round number down here. Now, I want to warn you, there is a very good chance this market gets some news tomorrow, runs down, and sits around that $50 a barrel. So one scenario you have to really respect tomorrow is if we get pinned right down to that low, right? And you'll see what I mean by pinned, right? The NASDAQ's pinned to its highs, the gold's pinned to its highs right now. So sometimes we get that move down and it just gets stuck there and it keeps going and keeps going. If we spend an hour or so down there around 50 tomorrow, now we know we have that range. And what do we do with a range, right? If we get that strong move down and they chop around that round number, what's gonna happen? The range up here now gets shifted down here. Okay, this is probably one of the most difficult types of range-bound markets to trade, because you've got to be aware the longer we sit down there, and it would make sense, right? $50 a barrel, it would make sense for them to stick down there. If they stick down there for a while, I'm now going to use the same strategy. I'm going to try to sell above that high, and my favorite way to sell above the high of a range is to wait for the price to pop above the range, wait for the counter trend buyers to come in and try to buy the pullback off the moving average. Then we know exactly where their stops are, we know exactly where their pain points are, and we can sell right into those stop losses. That is another scenario I'm watching here for tomorrow. So now we've got two, right? But what if we just take off, right? What if the number comes out horrible? What if we finally do hear from OPEC saying we decided not to cut production and this thing tanks, right? Where might it go? How can we trade it short as it goes lower? First of all, strong move down, right? That's the first leg. Second leg pulls back to the moving average, and third leg now jumps off the moving average. If we can get that 1-2-3 breakout, remember we're at a range right now, if we can get that 1-2-3 breakout, what's the best plan of attack? Mark up that low, find that hidden channel, and give it a good whack, right? That's going to be your most reliable trade. Again, the prerequisite for this though is strong move down, pull back to the moving average, and jump off the moving average. Right then, and like I always say in the newsletter, you've got to stay patient for that breakout, but then you've got to get aggressive at selling off the high of that channel. Okay, so now we get a pretty good plan. Now we got three ways I'm watching here to trade short on this oil, right? One above the range and two of them below the range, one of them being tricky with that new range coming out. Now, how do we buy this market? What do we do in a range, right? We buy low and we sell high. So I do want to be a buyer. I can be a buyer on this as long as I can get down inside this area here. Now remember, I've got this trend line here, my trend line here, right? That expanding triangle. We may see this thing go down, then go right back up to retest the high of that triangle, right? Could be an easy big rally off that, right, off that low. But the problem is we're bearish right now, aren't we? So how do we get long when the market's very bearish? We have to use that same failure pattern, but we got to give the bears the benefit of the doubt, right? We want to look for the one, the two, and then use the nested pattern, right, as we go. And again, you can see a good example back here, right? Watch the market goes lower. It pulls back. They try once. They try twice. And it shoots up from there. When you're trying to go against the short-term momentum, again, I know it's a range. I know I want to buy low, but I don't want to just try to get aggressive buying down here because I could be walking right into a mess, right? So bearish right now. So as we go lower, I've got my trend line. I've got my support levels down here. Wait for those bears to show their teeth. Once they show us they mean business, trying twice, now we know exactly where those stops are and look to pull the plug here and run it right back up into that range, right? We're buying right into those stop losses. Remember, buy underneath the range. Don't buy inside the range. If you miss it, do not chase after it as it goes back up into that trading range. That should be a pretty good setup. We got to get underneath the range though first. What else can we do here? What if the market is as bullish as it feels like it is right now? How can we trade this thing going higher here as we go higher? There are two patterns I'm watching for. One is a 1-2-3 breakout. This one doesn't need a lot of strength at the first leg, but you got to see a lot of strength coming off that moving average. Again, look back here. You can see how the buyers had everything they needed, but they couldn't continue it, right? They got to continue it. If you want to get a reversal, it's got to go up, but that's not enough. It has to pull back and hold that pullback and jump. Okay, the buyers haven't had that yet. It'll look a lot like this, right? It'll look like that. Strong move down, but bears come in, hit it. Right? That's a bear market. A bull market now has to do the same thing, right? Has to take the ball back, as we say in our trade room. Now, once I get that strong move off the moving average, I call it a 1-2-3 reversal or a 1-2-3 breakout. Then I'm going to mark up those highs, mark up that low, find that hidden channel, and we're buying off the low of that hidden channel. Again, you got to stay patient for the breakout, right? Don't be a hero trying to predict the breakout. And then get aggressive on that, right, on that pullback. Now, one more pattern here for the buyers. What if this thing rips higher, right? It easily could, right? The buyers want to go back up and retest those highs again. What would be a good way to trade it if it starts ripping higher here? Strong move up. Once you see this thing, you know, once you start seeing it, boom, 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 right? Big green candles. Now what I do is I wait for a shallow pullback, a higher high, right? I look for a second try from those bears and looking to buy into, again, I call this a 2-try breakout pattern. Now, as long as you can get into this pattern quickly, right? As long as you're not taking this pattern way up here, okay? If it goes all the way up, now what you're going to do is take a trap. So there's a very delicate, it's a very delicate environment when the market races higher. If you can get it before it gets within striking distance of the high, you don't need to trap low, right? But if it does get within striking distance, right? If this thing just runs and then pulls back once, you got to go in for a 2-try trap pattern here. You got to buy as low as you can because you know where they're trying to go. They're trying to go back up to retest the high. You'll need that, what I call a 2-try trap pattern, if it just rips higher and won't pull back. But if we get what usually happens, it'll make a nice strong run higher. Right, the buyers will take some profit. The bears will come in. They'll try to hit it again, right? And when they do, at that point now, the bears have tried twice now. Stops are sitting right above that high, a nice strong green candle, and we're good to go there. Again, like I mentioned earlier, right, traps are always excellent, right? So I definitely hope we get a trap, but it won't be necessary until we get closer to that high of day, right, back to retest those highs. So now we've got a pretty good plan. We get a definite bullish clue on the chart right now. I want to be a seller, though, until proven otherwise, right? Until the buyers can actually take control of this. I'm looking for nested failures off the highs, nested failures off the lows, possibly getting a breakout. And again, be aware of that breakdown into a trading range down here. Those are some tricky environments. And speaking of which, you know, we do a lot of work with trading ranges in our trade room. We'll do a lot of updates tomorrow in the trade room as well. If you're not going to trade this tomorrow with me in the trade room, the next best thing is to grab our free trading course. I'll put a link in the upper right-hand corner for you. Grab that link in the upper right-hand corner. get access to our free trading classes. Again, if you're not with me tomorrow in the trade room for Non-Farm Friday, the next best thing you can do is to make sure you get the most out of our time together. Grab that free course linked up in the upper right-hand corner. And just so you know, I'll put all the links tonight in the description of this YouTube video. So anything we talk about tonight, you can find all the links for membership, our free trading classes, and everything in between is linked up in the description. So now we're ready to rock and roll here. Oil is looking good. Excited for tomorrow here on oil. Hope I see you there tomorrow morning with us in the trade room. Let's keep going here. Oil is ready to go. How about some S&P? S&P, as you can see here, what do we know? We know the market is bullish overall, right? We know the market, of course. You look left, right, big bull run up. We also know that even though those buyers, right, collapsed here, they never came back to retest the low. That was a really interesting part of today's price action. This is another very small clue that really means bullish. It's a very bullish clue, right? On crude oil, we saw the lack of rotation, right? On the S&P, how on earth did they make that huge run up, collapse all the way back down, and not take out those lows? Think about that for a moment. That's a very bullish sign, and that's going to give those buyers a whole lot more confidence, isn't it? That's a very big, very small, but very big, important clue. So we know we're bullish overall, right? There's no doubt about that. There's no question about bullishness overall, right? And as if we needed more evidence of bullishness, they couldn't actually tap out those buyers who got in on the first candle of the day. Now, there's one kind of elephant in the room, and that is this strong move down. Right, that strong move down right there. Anytime I see a strong move in one direction, I always know there's potential for people to come out and take out that low, right? So we definitely do still have potential for that. Doesn't look like it right now, but you know, tomorrow is Non-Farm Friday. Anything could happen, but I do want to make note of that, that strong bear move. Anytime we see a strong bear move, they tried once, they're trying a couple times, they're failing here, obviously. But just don't be surprised here if we see this market overnight take a nosedive, right, to retest that low, almost as if to kind of finish the job off for those sellers. That strong move is a big, big clue. What else do we know right now? We know the market is a narrow range, right? What's a narrow range tell me? Narrow ranges. Now, we talk about ranges already, right? Ranges tell me balanced market. Right? What is a range market? A range market is balanced, right? So what goes up will usually come back down. What comes down will come back up. Okay, this is a very interesting type of trading range. You can see how narrow it is, right? It's paper thin. Now, whenever you see a narrow range, we always expect to see a bigger breakout. I talk about this all the time. We take the size of the range and we use that to create our buy and sell zones. Now, you might notice here, these are a bit wider. They're actually a 2-to-1, right? So I talked about the wide ranges last night. This is a polar opposite, right? This is a narrow range. In a narrow range, what I'll do is I'll take the 2-to-1, right, and create the sell zones overhead. That's why this level up here is a lot higher than just simply copying and pasting that range, right? We do that a lot in our trade room where we'll take the range, we'll copy and paste it once, right? Copy and paste it twice. And you can see what I'm doing here. I'm just simply widening out those levels. Now, why do I do that? Why do you widen out the levels with a narrow range? It's all about risk reward, right? I have to get, literally, I've got to get a big move down for me to be able to get any real meat on that bone. Right? If I just try to buy underneath the small little range here, that's not a lot of meat on that bone. There's not a lot of reward for the risk. So the best advice I can give you is whenever you see a narrow range, really stay patient for a big move up. That way traders can get a good risk reward ratio and dump it back down. Big move down, right back up. It's all about where can traders find the best risk reward ratios. And whenever we have a narrow range, it's not gonna be within those first couple of range expansions. And right now the market's obviously very consolidated. We got big news tomorrow morning, right? It's understandable. But tomorrow morning though, I do wanna try to really focus on selling high if we get the right setup, buying low with the right setup, and really staying away from this middle. It's a very narrow range. It's almost the opposite of the problem we had last night on that wide range. Wide ranges have no problem getting good risk reward, so you don't have to worry about big breakouts. Narrow ranges, you gotta get big breakouts to fade those breakouts to make it worth the risk you gotta take on that trading range. What else do we know right now? Look left here. Look left. That is a beautiful reversal line back here. That level at 33.30, 33.29 area, that just lines up so nicely with the buy zone here. So we know we get the range. We know we've got the buy zone here underneath, right? And we know that, right? We know that that green line back there, right? That 33.30 area, that's a great spot for it as well. I really like that reversal line there at that 33.28 half, right? The reversal line at 28 half. So we know we're bullish. We know we're in a narrow range. We know the buyers, right? They want to go back up and retest those highs. The bears want to get pummeling right back down in. How do we trade this right now? Well, I'm going to be a buyer, right? I want to be a buyer here in a bull market. So how do we buy underneath the range? I'm looking for a move down, right? Get down inside that buy zone, get outside of that narrow range, right? So I can now start to, right? I can now start to look for a failure. Hopefully we'll get this market to come down, right? Get that moving average coming over. And we'll just simply wait for those bears to come in and try, take a swing so we can buy into those stop losses. Right? Typical failure pattern. Get underneath the range, wait for the moving average to come over, get those bears to commit off the EMA. We look for that failure, right, into pullback combination as we go back up into that trading range. And again, as I mentioned earlier, I talk a lot about these patterns inside that free trading course. Not to mention, you'll see hundreds of examples of how we apply these failures and pullback combinations right in our trade room. So very, very reliable pattern there. Now, we got that 33.28, right? So what if we really collapse here, right? We dig into that reversal line down there. Now what do? I still want to be a buyer on this, but now we got to use that nested failure, right? One try for the bears, two try for the bears. Now remember, a lot of times these nested patterns, they will rip higher after those failures happen. And if it does, don't chase after it. Look for that two try trap, right? Here's another scenario you're watching for. Now, why are these two different, right? Why are they different? They're different because of momentum, right? If I see a pullback down to this, right, down to retest this low here, we pull back down to the low, momentum's not going to be a big concern, right? So once those bears come in, try to sell off the EMA, I now know where their stops are, right, where their pain points are. I now can buy into those stops, and usually it'll pull right back to the EMA, and I can buy that pullback off the EMA, a failure into pullback combination. But if we do get that deep pullback down to that 28 half area, now this market isn't as bullish anymore, right? It's still bullish overall, but that short-term move down, though, tells me, right? And again, this is all kind of waiting on that deep, deep pullback. Once the deep pullback, now we know momentum is a little stronger for the bears. Give them once. Give them twice, and then we know again, we know right where their stops are, right? And we can look for a buying opportunity now right into those stops. And again, a lot of times when that pattern triggers, it's not going to waste any time. A lot of times when those bears fail, this thing rips higher, and you don't want to chase after it if it runs higher like that. Wait for a 1-2 trap low and grab that 2-try trap pattern off of that low. Those are a couple different patterns I'm watching for tomorrow, right? Four of them. A failure pattern, a nested failure, a pullback off the low, and a 2-try trap pattern. Now, how do we buy as the market's going higher? As the market's going higher, we have to know, first of all, what we're dealing with. The buyers want to go back to retest the high of day at 33.57 and 3/4. So I've got one option where I could go for the 1-2-3 breakout, right? And it's a range after all. But the problem now is the chances of getting to that high are pretty good. So it's going to be a bit difficult. You would have to literally get a 1-2-3 breakout. 1-2-3 breakout, it's going to be very, very tight here. Trying to thread that needle. If you can get it, right? If it really jumps, pulls back and go, you can get it off that low. But I would assume, though, if we get a strong move up and they hold that pullback, we'll be running right into the high of that day. And you just don't want to be buying into that, right? That's not the time to be buying that pullback. If we do get that 1-2-3, at that point, I want to see them hold another pullback here and really show me proof there. And again, we'll talk about the sell side here in just a few seconds. What I'd rather do, though, is get that 2-try trap pattern, right? That strong move up, pull back, higher high, trap low, and go from there. Remember, this whole thing is all based on a real strong push higher. Then you look for the higher high. Then what usually happens is it'll go just below the moving average, right? I always like to go looking for a hidden channel, right, and grab that trap right below the low of that pullback, right? So strong move up, that sets the table. short-term shallow pullback, higher high, trap low. It'll usually be just below the moving average, right? If we really get lucky, we can combine a prior high with a prior low, find that hidden channel, right, and give it a good whack. It'll usually go right back up to retest the high, and then from there, we'll see where we go from there, right? So let's talk about that. What if we don't, right? What if we get it just rips higher here? Then what might happen? We may go sideways up here, right? Kind of the opposite we talked about on crude oil. Right, so just when we talk about oil, oil might get pinned to its lows, S&P might get pinned to its highs. If it gets pinned, right, in other words, the buyers keep buying, but eventually they're going to run out of bullets, and eventually they'll pull back off that high. Assuming we've spent at least an hour sitting at that high, right, on a range up there, now I know the buyers want that higher price. To the NASDAQ, we'll take a look at that in a second here. I want to get the moving average coming down, get those bears. What'll happen is the bears will try to call that top and sell back down. The problem is, if we sit up around that highs for a while, right? We go up and we just sit there and stay pinned to that high. This is not a bear market, right? So sellers here trying to sell that pullback, they're on the wrong side of the odds, right? The right side of the odds is to wait for those bears to try, wait for them to fail, and literally buy right into those stop losses for that run back up. Right, that will take some time, obviously, because you got to wait for the range to show up. But once we see that trading range and the market sits there like that, wait for the pullback, wait for those counter trend bears to come in trying to sell that top and literally buy right into those stop losses. And then obviously, right, as we go higher, could I sell off this high? We definitely can, but we need to be careful how we sell this market because obviously it's a very bullish market. So here's one pattern I'm watching here for tomorrow. If we can get up to retest the high, I'll then look for what's called a crown reversal pattern. And it's basically a nested failure with a little trap on top, right? A little trap with a cherry on top. In other words, when I pull back to that moving average, the buyers try to hold it, but they fail to retest the high. Then they go lower, right? They go lower to attract more buyers. And at that point now all those sellers are waiting right above that high, right? Once they see that lower high, they know there's now a trend line coming down. And that trend line will keep a lot of those buyers away. We oftentimes see the buyers try one more time. And if I can get that trap high up there, that is going to be a great setup for what I call a crown reversal pattern. And again, notice, right? Notice kind of how this thing sets up. It's not the two try trap with the higher highs, right? The higher highs are what give away a two-try trap. This one goes up, it pulls back with a lower high, tries again at a lower low, right? See it again? It's a lower low and a lower high there. Then the buyers come in, they try a second time, they get that trap above that high. And once you see that big, juicy red candle coming off that high, party's over, kids, and we're going right back down into that trading range. That would be a great sell right as we go back up to retest the high. And then as always, right, how do we go lower? If we go lower here, 1, 2, 3, break down, right? So if I run lower, I can't sell that pullback, right? Right, I can't sell that because, again, look where we are. You're at the low of that range. But if I can see the bears hold that pullback and make a run for it, if they make a good run for it, now we know the bears have it. Now I can mark up that low, create the channel, right, the hidden channel. And then, again, these usually take longer than we'd like them to. But once you see those 1, 2, 3 reversals, in this case, 1, 2, 3 breakout as well, you know exactly where, right, to look for that short off the high of that hidden channel. Targets for the buyers are back up to retest the high. Targets for the sellers, where's my bear target right now? We got 3,300. Remember, tomorrow's a big news day. So we could easily have this thing really collapse there tomorrow. 3,300 is an easy, easy milestone, right, if the bears can take it tomorrow. But again, right, we're all kind of waiting on this news number tomorrow morning at 8:30 Eastern time. It's a bull market with a range. Buy low, sell high. I can be aggressive buying off the low. I've got to be very patient with those crown reversals selling off the high. S&P is looking great. Don't forget, if you're not trading with me tomorrow, grab that free course linked up in the upper right-hand corner. Let's keep this party rolling here tonight. How about the NASDAQ right now? So NASDAQ, you can see once again, right, the NASDAQ is kind of leading the way here. We've seen this quite a bit over the last couple of weeks here on the NQ. What do we know about the NASDAQ right now? We know the NASDAQ is bullish. I think that's pretty easy to see. bull market tells me I want to buy at support. What else do we see here? We see this little tiny range, right? They spent a lot of time here today, about 11 o'clock, the rest of the afternoon, trading inside of that range. What does the range tell me to do? Buy low, sell high, avoid the middle, right? So we know they're technically breaking out of this range right now. Not a very safe place to be buying breakouts, right? We also know if we could get down underneath that range, that would be a fantastic spot for us to find some buy setups here tomorrow. We know we're bullish, so we're trying to find levels of support. I love this hidden channel here as well. This would be kind of the dream come true for buyers tomorrow. If we could get down to that low of that hidden channel, and you'll notice how I draw the channel, right? I'm drawing off these two highs. I'm bringing it down to that low. The midline fits like a glove. Beautiful midline on it. So again, if we could get down to that low, that will tick a lot of boxes, right? Look how much support is down there at that 94.15, 94.16 area. The low of that hidden channel. I've got my trading range, right? Which again is relatively narrow, waiting for a relatively big breakout of that range. I've also got that up, down, up. That is a beautiful reversal line, right? That would be a great spot as support as well. So a great, great level of support down there. I just hope we get a chance to take it, right? That's all. That's my only concern right now. This NASDAQ looks like it's got one thing on its mind, and that is that big round number at 9,500. Let's not get ahead of ourselves though, right? The NASDAQ is right back to those all-time highs right now. Not a time to be trying to gamble buying breakouts. So how do we buy this market? And then of course, talk about how do we sell it as well, right? I know I wanna be a buyer. I wanna buy preferably underneath this trading range. Now we talked about this last night and we talked about this quite a bit, right? It's all about momentum, right? I know where the battle zones are, right? Down those lows here. Now let's talk about one scenario. One scenario would be we end up going up, right? Crown reversal back into the range and we sit back in that range, right? So one scenario to consider for tomorrow. And again, I want to be ready for all of these if then scenarios, right? If we get that, then we do that. If we end up back in that range and we sit inside that range tomorrow, that's going to absorb a lot of momentum. Then if I get that run lower, which will typically be like a pendulum swing, right? Then what I'll do is I can buy into a seller failure. And of course, right, look for that bullish pullback. Make sense? So again, I can use that classic failure into pullback combination and buy it back up into that range. But again, this all kind of hinges on it has to hang out inside that trading range. If it doesn't, right, if we go up, and of course, buyers take profit at all-time highs. If we go up and collapse back down now, what's going to happen? It's a very bear market now, right? It's overall bullish, of course, right? But that's going to be a hell of a lot of bear momentum. And that momentum is going to spook a lot of buyers. So instead of being aggressive on it now, I use the nested failure. You got it. One try, two try, and then back up from there. Does that make sense, right? So if I'm going to be a buyer, I already know where I want to buy, right? I want to buy this area down here. If it slices through the range, now momentum looks really strong, right? Look for one, look for two, back up from there. Or do we go back into the range, hang out for a while, and then make a move down? That's not nearly as intimidating, right? In that situation, I can use that failure, right? And then go right back up. It's the difference between if momentum is strong for the bears and I still want to buy, I let them try twice, right? It's a great example of that two try rule. Good stuff there, right? So now we know if we get that pullback, watch how the market pulls back, because that will be a big part of which pattern we're going to choose. Now, as we go higher here, right, how do we buy a break going higher? I've got that measured move overhead, right, that measured move there at 94.80. So really, this is going to be all about strength, right? Do we see a market like the NASDAQ? Does it jump up and go sideways at that, right, at that measured move? It could easily happen, right? Just like this one back here, right? We go up, we go sideways, right? That could happen. We go up, we reach the next measured move. The market sits here and goes sideways. What do you do? you buy underneath the range, right? Ranges are balanced. We wait for the price to pull back. We wait for those bears to come in and foolishly try to call that top, right? And we buy into their stop losses. That is something I'm watching. But again, the prerequisite for this is it's got to sit at that high for a while to be able to get enough buyers to commit when it pulls back on the next pullback. The other two patterns would be that strong move up, right? That pullback to the EMA, and that jump off the moving average. If that's the case, you know exactly where they're going. They're going right to that big round number. My job now is find my channel and try to get in off the low of that channel, right? It might not be easy. They may just slam right back up to that 9,500, right? They may just go bam and then go sideways up here. Same idea, right? If it sits there and goes sideways, you know the drill. Failure, buy it right back up again. One more pattern here is that two try breakout, right? Strong move up, right? Strong move up. And you know, think of it this way. Look back at this one back here, right? Strong move up. What happens? Shallow pullback, higher high. Everybody piles on now, right below that low. Does that make sense? Right? That pattern up here, right? So what do we get? We get boom, boom, right? Big move up, big explosive move higher here. We don't chase after it because, well, sometimes the market goes straight up and straight back down, especially before a major news event. So we make that strong run up, right? Big green candles. It's got that feeling like it's never going to stop. Shallow pullback, higher high. And then again, usually what's going to happen is buyers will now come in and they'll start waiting right below that low. What'll happen is the moving average comes over and it's usually just below that moving average. That's what I always tell my clients, right? Once it pulls back and traps just below that moving average, that's usually where you'll notice a lot of the best entries, they come just below the moving average in a bull market, right? I know. We like to think of the moving average as a level of support, but when you get below the EMA, you confuse people, right? You confuse. Momentum tells us to keep buying, but that traps in those bears trying to get short going back down in. And again, I always like to grab a little hidden channel, right? Find a little hidden channel there and get aggressive. It's a very aggressive market. Those are the times you've got to get aggressive. You don't, you're not going to get those deep, deep pullbacks, right? We know where the market wants to go up to that big round number. So now we know how to buy this thing, right? Now we know how to buy this thing as it goes higher, as it pulls back. Could I sell this market? You know, I said this last night too, right? You really got to be careful being a seller in this market right now. How could you sell this thing? Well, we already know we're at resistance at the all-time high. So you definitely could look for that crown reversal, right? Strong move up, buyers try once, they fail to retest the high, they pull back, buyers try twice. I'm definitely not going to say it's the most reliable trade I've ever seen because you can obviously see how bullish this market is right now. But if you have the guts to short the high of this market right now, that would be the pattern I would trust for it. A crown reversal pattern to be a seller. Or maybe we see this thing nosedive, right? Maybe it runs up, nosedives, goes lower, right? They hold that pullback and they jump off that moving average. If that's the case, they're trying to go right down to retest that low. If we can get that 1, 2, 3 reversal, yeah, mark up that low. Again, it's not what I expect, but anything can happen, right? And you don't want to be, you know, kind of married to, as they say, one side of it. You've got to be open-minded to letting the market tell you what's going to do, right? I don't tell the market what to do, right? If the market takes off the downside here, I already know my plan, right? What is it? If it doesn't respect the range, it's a nested and then back up in. That's the if-then statement, right? If it runs through and holds the pullback and jumps off the EMA, now it's a bear market. It does take some patience to wait for the reversal. I'm not trying to pull the trigger on that pullback. It's not a reliable trade, right? What I will do though is once I do see proof, then I can mark up the low, then I can mark up the high, and then is the time to get aggressive, right? Because you're probably not going to get a perfect entry set up. You know, there won't be some silver platter sell off that high. That's what I mean when I say you got to get aggressive on it, right? You're usually going to see kind of a half-baked entry pattern off that high, but you got to just be aggressive with it because everyone's waiting for the pullback, right? Down to that low at 62.25. All right, guys, we got a pretty good plan here for the NASDAQ. The big thing about the NASDAQ is how do we respond to that range, right? Do we jump up and go into a range up top? You know, that might actually be the easiest part of tomorrow. If we jump up and they start going sideways up here, the plan is really simple. Just wait for that pullback, that failure, and keep buying it right up. right? Until, of course, they hold the pullback and they dump. Once they do that, draw the channel, right? And you know it's a channel now to sell off that high. Right? And again, guys, I'm simply trying to draw up on the charts. I'm getting myself ready. I'm getting my clients ready for tomorrow as well. But again, if you're not with me tomorrow in the trade room, the next best thing is to grab that free course linked up in the upper right-hand corner. That way, when I say a nested failure, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about because you've gone through our free trading course. All right, good to go. NASDAQ looks great there. The buy side and the sell side. How about some gold right now? How about some yellow metal? What do we know about gold here tonight? Well, we know we're bullish on the gold. That's pretty easy to see. What does a bull market tell me? It tells me to buy low, buy at support. Yeah, something new here, right? Yeah, we haven't seen any of these here tonight. It's a trading range there, right? What does the range tell me to do? Range tells me to buy low. Range tells me to sell high. Obviously, because it's a bull market, I want to be a little more disciplined when it comes to selling, right? I could be a lot more aggressive being a buyer than I can be a seller, okay? Anytime I see a trading range, I'm always looking out for these expanding triangles. I'll tell you right now, gold loves these expanding triangles. The only thing I really am worried about tomorrow is the fact that we got news at 8:30. You know, like I said earlier, gold is one of those markets that will get a bit squirrely right around that news. So be careful, especially if trading this overnight. But man, oh man, that expanding triangle looks gorgeous. That is a great expanding triangle because, of course, the size of that range, right, determines my buy zone down here, right? The battle zone, we call it. And I call it a battle zone because what's going to happen is when the market runs lower, the buyers and sellers will go to battle. Right? And usually the one who has control of the trend is who wins that battle. Right? Makes sense? That's why I call it the battle zone. Now, what else do we see here right now? Look at that reversal line. We talk a lot about reversal lines. I'll tell you right now, every morning we open up the trade room, I always say, okay, where's the reversal line? Where's the naked reversal line? Where's a prior level of resistance? That's what it was, that now can be used as support. And it's right there. You'll notice right where it is. It's right around the low of that triangle. Beautiful spot for it. And then, of course, we don't see this very often, but a classic trend line. Yeah, believe it or not, a classic trend line. Now, this trend line is a really good example of something that we may not be able to use. Because if it pulls back right now, I can buy off of it. Make sense? But if it sits here for a while, right, and then we try to buy off it, that's not a very good trade, is it? Why? Because of risk-reward ratio. I can't risk small to earn large if I buy really close to that range. Make sense? Right? If I can get a deep pullback now, right? Yeah, now I could risk small to earn large. But again, this trend line, it's a very good example of this trend line now. I've got to go now, right? It has to be used now. If this thing kind of fiddles around for a while and then it goes into the trend line, you know what? It might work, but I'm not taking that trade. No, it's definitely not a reliable trade because look, right, we've already seen tons of rejection at that high. So think of that trend line. Honestly, you almost want to remove that trend line right from the screen, right? In these situations, what you're looking for is you're looking for those trend lines to get better with age, right? Like a fine wine, right? It gets better as the time goes on. If it wants to sit up here, great. Finally pulls back, beautiful. It's a much deeper pullback. Does that make sense? Those are the types of levels that you really want to stay patient for. The only variable right now is how the market will respond to that news tomorrow morning. Okay, what else do we know here right now? We know the buyers, they want to get up to that next measured move. One leg, two leg, three leg. We know where they're trying to go. Very important if you're trying to break out. Where do the sellers want to go? The bears obviously want to go back down to retest that low at 1551, but there's that big range down there. So extend that range out a little bit. You know, like that, and that's where the bears want to go, right? So bears want to get back into that range, which is really, really important to remember because if we do get the reversal, we really got to be keen on getting in quickly. We can't wait too long, all right? So now that we know that is in play, get that updated there, perfect. Now, we know we're bullish, we know we're in a range, we know we want to be a buyer underneath that range here. Let's zoom in a little bit closer here right now. How do we buy this market? One easy way would be we get down into our buy zone, right? And notice how I've broken these down in one zone and two zones here. I do that for a reason. If I get in the first zone, momentum's not a very big concern, is it? So I can now look for that seller failure off of that moving average. Again, you know, think about it. Market takes off the downside, right? There's a lot of rookies out there. I used to be one of them, okay? You might be brand new too. There's a lot of rookies out there that are not trading with a plan. They don't have a plan. They're not prepared for the emotions that are going to trigger them in, right? When I was a rookie, I was on a 144 tick chart, 89 tick chart. If we see a strong move down, right, it will look very bearish to someone who's not prepared for it, and they're not mentally ready to be disciplined not to grab that. You know what I mean? When you're a rookie, you're busy watching so many different things that it's almost like you can't help yourself, right? The move runs lower. You know what I'm talking about, right? I was the same way when I was a rookie. It was like I was trying to learn everything, and I would see that big move down, and it's like my mouse would just do it by itself and click off that cell. The problem is, again, right, we have to assume these buyers have control right now. The market will, chances are, go right back up into that range again. And that's exactly what we're trying to do, right? Once we see those, and again, you assume these are rookies because rookies are the ones that will take those types of trades, that strong move down, right? People are not going to be mentally prepared to be disciplined not to take that trade. They'll almost automatically jump in. And once they do that, you know exactly where the stops are. And now the writing's on the wall. Once we hit those stops, it'll almost always run right back up into that range. Now, what if we get a little bit deeper pullback? I get that secondary range down here, right? What if we get that deeper pullback? Now, this is an example where you can actually use that trend line, right? Bring that trend line down, get that moving average here, right? And if we can get above that trend line, oh, game over, right? If we get above that trend line, remember, if we do get that deep, deep pullback, right, you're gonna want to respect momentum, right? So if it does, again, if it goes into the first one, it's a straight seller failure, into bullish pullback, and then back up into that range. But if it really tanks, again, tomorrow's big news day. If it really tanks now, watch that moving average come down. We do want to buy still. There's no doubt about that. But now we want to make sure we treat the bears with respect. We respect them by letting them try once, let them try twice. And again, notice how I draw this. Higher highs, right? You got to have higher highs because what's going to happen? The bears want to sell high. Right, so you got to see those higher highs there. Once those bears try once, once they try twice, the aggressive sellers try, right? The conservative bears try. Now we know exactly where their stops are. And remember, a lot of times, these big moves, when they fail, they snap right back higher. You don't want to chase after it. If it does snap, look for that trap, right? That two-try trap pattern. It's that same pattern we keep talking about, right? It's a higher high. It'll usually go just below the moving average, you know what I mean? Right? So seller failure, nested failure as we call it, into a two-try trap pattern. Or, right, maybe it's a pullback pattern going back up into that trading range. Those are a couple things I'm watching for here tomorrow. Again, stay out of the middle, right? If we sit, stay away, wait for the pullback, wait for those bears to try and fail and buy right into those stop losses. Now, the hard part is going to be, how do we do this if it breaks out? Right? So it breaks out higher, right? We're probably not going to have enough space up here for a 1-2-3 pullback, right? 1-2-3 breakout, probably not going to be the right timing for it, right? What will probably happen is it'll probably get stuck up here and you might get trapped on the wrong side of this. What I'd rather do is, if we do see that strong breakout, know where they're trying to go and look for that two-try trap. One try, higher high, two try, right? And buy that trap from there. The reason why you want a trap pattern and not just like this one back here, right, where it jumps up, the bears try once, the bears try twice. If you've got plenty of space overhead, right, then absolutely you can, right, if we didn't have this level of concern overhead and it jumps up, sure, one, two, you can buy that two-try breakout, no problem. But we don't have a lot of unlimited space up there. We got that measured move right in the way. So as we go higher, strong move up, pull back, shallow pull back, trap, and go from there. And again, this will usually be just below, right, that EMA, right? Grab that hidden channel, combine below that hidden channel. That's a great setup. It's a great setup. Again, you gotta wait for it, but it's worth the wait. It's better than just gambling and chasing after it as it goes. Now, what if it really does go, right? You know, what if the number comes out tomorrow? Get a big level up top here, 1585, 1584. So, right, if we do end up making a run, this darn software keeps on messing up on me here. If we do end up going for a run, right, with a 1-2-3 breakout, if we do get that 1-2-3 breakout higher and I can get through that measured move, wonderful. Now I can look for that hidden channel pullback, right, and I can buy it now going back up, right, to those highs up there at 84.5. that 84 half high over there will be a great level of resistance here for those bulls. So that's kind of the biggest challenge we have right now. We got to get through that measured move right now. We got to go up, hold that pullback, right, and really jump through that measured move. Then I know I can trust it, and now I can find my channel, and I can buy off the low of that hidden channel. All right, so hopefully that makes sense there as we go higher. So now we've got a pretty good plan here how we're going to buy this thing. How do we sell this market? Being a seller on this is obviously not going to be easy because we're so bullish in the short term. So as I go higher, I get up around my trend line overhead, up inside my sell zone overhead. We go up. What's the best pattern to sell a bull market? Crown reversal, right? One try, two try. I would like to get a trap on this, right? It is gold. It is a news day. I would like to make sure I get a trap on that to really solidify the most reliable version of that pattern, right? If you want to be aggressive with it, go up, right? One try, two try, and sell back down in. Just kind of seeing how bullish this market is right now, though, I think it would be a good idea, though, here to be able to go up. Crown reversal, one, two, trap, and then back down from there. Again, it takes some time to get the pattern, right? Lower lows in price, trap high. That's the key, right? We go up, the buyers try once, they fail to retest the high, they try it again, they come up, and they trap high before they retest that high. Nice big strong red candle, right? Sell that sucker back down into that trading range. That crown reversal is my go-to pattern whenever I'm worried about momentum, right? But at the same time, I do have a level of resistance that I can trust, like the top of a triangle or a range expansion level. Now, again, as we go lower here, it's not going to be easy to get short. Got a lot of support if you look left over here. So what do I need to see as we go lower? What I'd like to see is that strong move down, you know, get down into these support levels, get that moving average coming over, and actually hold that pullback and jump. Once I get that momentum off the moving average, now we know the market's bearish. I'm running that low off that high. We know exactly where our hidden channel top is going to be. Again, I know it takes some time to get these reversals, right? But your only other option is to guess. And guessing this doesn't work very well, especially when the market is bullish and you're trying to reverse and break out of a range. So one, two, three, breakout. Again, one, strong move down. Two, pull back to the EMA. Three, break down. One, two, three, breakout into a hidden channel pullback. The more aggressive entry, obviously, is a strong move down. I worry about this one, though, because of that reversal line. My biggest concern about a strong breakdown with a two-try breakout would be that reversal line there at 62. So if we do get that move, it really goes one, two. But it's going to be really big, though. Right, again, you got that lower, right, that lower low, moving average comes over. So this one's really got to rip lower. It's got to get clearly underneath that reverse line at 62.8, and then I can think about being a seller from there. Again, we got that, right, possible strong move down, profit taking, lower low, trap high, right, and then we go out from there. Looking good. All right, so now we know the plan for the gold to be a buyer. We're buying underneath the range. Watch how steep or how sharp the pullback is. That will determine, right? Do we pull back in the shallow spot? Do we pull back nice and deep? That will tell us what type of entry pattern to use. If you want to be a seller on it, be conservative on a sell side. And again, overnight here on the gold, be very, very careful, right, in the overnight right now, because we do have that big news for tomorrow. Looks like oil starting to break higher here. We're on the right track for oil. We'll see what the next couple hours bring. Don't forget tomorrow morning and every morning, 8 o'clock Eastern time, come out and join me. Come trade this strategy with me. It's a professional trade room, a professional strategy. I've got all the tools, all the cheat sheets, everything you need to be successful is all included as an advanced member right here at School of Trade. I'll put all the links, as I mentioned earlier, I'll put the registration link for tomorrow's trade room in the description of the YouTube video. So grab that link and get registered for tomorrow. Don't be afraid to call me in the office. I'll be here all evening tonight. I can gladly help walk you through the entire process of getting registered or use that live support tool. I'll be watching that here for the rest of the evening as well. And as always, don't forget, if membership isn't quite right for you today, don't be afraid to grab that free trial. That free trial has our free trading courses, right? Our free pass to our trade room, hundreds of hours of of examples of how we apply our three-step strategy to our favorite futures markets. So if membership isn't right for you right now, make sure you grab that free trading course as part of the free trial. Give us a call here in the office if you guys have any questions. Use live support. All the links, the description of the YouTube video. And again, make sure you subscribe to this YouTube channel. Hit that thumbs up button if you're still watching. Been a great week here. But we got one more day left for tomorrow. Hope I'll see you there, 8 o'clock Eastern time. If not, be careful out there, right? Follow the plan, and we'll see you guys next time. My name is Joseph. Be well out there. Be nice to each other, will ya? And be here next time. Adios, amigos. Bye-bye for now.